Professor Dr. Subair Ahmed Khan, who's from University School of Law and Legal Studies, IP University. Especially because IP University, in fact, I had the opportunity to go through the curriculum and every course as a professional skill development program, if I'm not wrong, that every paper has a component, in fact, integrated into it. And Professor has been in law school and probably he would be able to take us through how IP University also works on this front. In fact, Professor has obtained his PhD also from IP University and he is also a member of the All India Law Teachers Congress with Indian Institute of Public Administration and other academic bodies. And apart from that, he's presented his papers in multiple seminars at national and international level. And he's also part of the Legal Aid Society. So I would, over to you, Professor Subair. We look forward to hearing from you. His topic is on role of law clinic and clinical legal education in providing legal services in post-COVID world. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, organizers, for giving me the opportunity to present my paper. I'm myself Dr. Zubair Ahmed Khan, and my topic, as I said by the moderator, ma'am. So let me screen the share also. The topic of my presentation, which is as mentioned by this role of law clinics and clinical legal education providing legal services in post-COVID world. Now there are major issues which we are facing even today in this pandemic situation, and we have seen that this pandemic phase has actually collapsed the overall system across the countries, whether it is the developed countries, whether it is the developing countries also. And we have seen that in our countries, in the third world countries, especially India and in the African countries, as well as in the developed countries also, the National Legal Service Authority plays a very important role in providing the best possible legal services to the citizen of their respective country, and even to the indigent person also. So far as good, we have seen that how the Legal Service Authority plays a very important role. But the kind of pandemic which we have today altogether and the kind of situation which we are facing in our country is altogether different. In our country, there are more than 1,100 colleges are there, in which more than 800 are private universities, and remaining are the public sector universities also. There are few national law universities, around 23, few may more come up. And we have seen that the law schools have a certain contextual problem. In fact, I have been the part of Legal Aid Societies for the last 8 years. And I also been a part core member of the national project, which we have taken, that is the digitization of legal aid with the Ministry of Law Department Justice also, where we have done extensive empirical research in Uttar Pradesh, in one of the state of India also, and in UP and in Delhi also, Himachal Pradesh also, where we have found out that there is a complete gap between theory and practice also. So as I said, that since it is a contextual problem, we found out the law education colleges, they teach law universally, but they're ignoring the context also. I remember I start with my presentation with the quote which has been given by our late Professor Madhav Menon, who's considered to be the father of modern legal education, modern legal, like in the clinical legal education. He said, the beauty of clinical education as a pedagogic technique and its focus on the learning and the process of learning. But he raises the plight that now this focus has been shifting altogether. Now we have seen the faculty members who are looking for the promotional schemes, issues for their career advancement mechanisms also. And over the period of time, we saw that the clinical education, which is the most fundamental thing for every law teacher, every lawyer altogether, has been moved away altogether. He also said about that the time has come to look forward for the educational psychology also and evaluate different strategies of the learning also. As I said by the previous the speaker also, Nitish, where he has spoken that now the time has come to evolve different teaching of different methodology of teaching. So it is very much important that we should evolve all those things. Now, over the period of time, what we have seen that the clinical legal education, as described by the other thing also, that it is a multi-discipline and multi-purpose education also. We cannot read law in isolation, because as we've seen that there is a difference between theory and practice also. So the multidimensional approach is very much required also. Either law as a economics, law as a society, and the law as a biology also, or law as an environment also. So this clinical education does not have any specific definition as such. But due to the lack of definition also, we're trying somehow to draw an analogy also from the medical clinics also, that how a doctor actually treats its patient. In the same way, a law clinic play a very important role for the lawyers and for the paralegal volunteers also. And we have seen that this law clinic is actually a combination of legal education and the legal aid also, where the student can learn the negotiation skills, they can learn the leadership skills also. Now, this legal leadership skills or the negotiation skills seems to be the most important thing. Because over the period of time, whatever guidelines which have come across in our country or in the third world countries also, they have discussed that the legal education is based upon three apparent principles also. Number one is knowledge, number two is practice, and number three is professionalism also. It is not necessary one who have knowledge who can actually implement or can actually practice the same. In the same way, it is not necessary when you practice the same knowledge, you will evolve through the stages of professionalism also. So all three stages have their own respective importance. That is why the leadership skills seems to be most important altogether. Now in our country, whatever law clinic which we have observed through the research, my research proposal also, where I find out that these have been classified in three models also. One is the individual service model, second is the specialization model, and third one is the community model also. Individual service model is an area where we look upon the vulnerable section of society, on which is individual targeted altogether, and we try to provide the legal services either with the help of state legal service authority in that specific district on that respective state, or by taking the help from alumni lawyers also. But again, there are many challenges in the individual service model also, because we have seen and we have concluded from our project also that in our country, we have seen that all those impaneled lawyers are not really, really equipped enough to resolve the cases. They are mainly involved themselves in giving legal assistance, which is of no use for the paralegal, for the clients also. And that raises the plight of the Indian legal education altogether. And this has been raised in many courts, in many judgments as well also. So this is individual service model. Second is the specialization model. Now, specialization model is also a very important area altogether. Now, time has come altogether that with the need of the present scenario, we keep on working. For example, right now I'm working upon the water conservation in Dwarka, because I'm living in Dwarka and it's a place in New Delhi, India, where there is this water crisis is a major issue altogether. So I have been associated with certain specific district Jal Board, that is Water Board, where we are working about this specialization model. How can we conserve water also? How can we give legal awareness to the society, not only for conservation, but for the preservation also, and with regard to cleanliness also. For that thing, we may have to take help from certain municipal bodies also, the local bodies as well also. But specialization models has its own critique also, has its own challenges. I'm teaching banking insurance law for my LLM students and LLB students also. But I'm facing problems when I go and I ask my students to do PhD activities, that is professional skill development activities as set by the moderator ma'am, where I've asked them to go for the documentation for the Mediclaim insurance for the senior citizens or the person with disabilities or for the other vulnerable section of societies. We have faced a lot of challenges also, because the IRDA model, that is the insurance regulatory models which have created the insurance law altogether, are not really convenient to these senior citizens or the other vulnerable section of society also. So in that way also, the documentation process seems to be one of the major reasons in the specialization model also. We also believe in the principle of cooperative teaching. So we keep on interacting with other faculty members, where some of my faculty members are involved in the family law in ADR also. So there we are facing certain problems with regard to that also. For example, in the case of domestic violence, I try to mediate the domestic violence issue altogether outside the court. But at the same time, there the issues has been raised, and then later on it has been decided that now we have to file an FIR. But the lady has decided, no, I'm not going to file the FIR. She backed out also. So again, the kind of lack of confidence seems to be one of the major area also. In specialization model, this is one gray area also. Community model is again very important thing also. There are many stratification which exist in our society also. Now in the pandemic phase, we have seen that everyone has converted themselves into a virtual teaching model altogether. But the major, the plight of digital education in our country is very, very bad altogether. And especially those law schools which has exist in the tier 2 or the tier 3 cities also, they're not able to go and implement the digital education altogether, which has been consistently given by UGC and Bar Council of India. And unfortunately, there is no study which has been done altogether. How can we implement digital education in those rural areas or in those semi-urban areas where those law colleges are established also? And that is why the community model seems to be one of the important area altogether. That now the time has come that all those law schools which have established across the countries in tier 2 or tier 3 cities also, they have to establish certain community model also, where they can work upon community outreach program altogether. So this is something which seems to be important altogether for bringing the awareness for the students of law, as well as for the impanel lawyers, legal counsels also. Now, what is the need of clinical legal education? As I said, it is going to generate practical training. It has also been discussed by the other speakers also, that it is a kind of experimental education also, and experimental learning, which seems to be one of the important area altogether. Now, over the period of time, we have seen that all those practical challenges which we have seen, it has many dimensions altogether, where they can work upon the communication skills, they work upon the interviewing of clients and witnesses also, and the counselings and drafting also. Now, initially we have seen that there are many activities which has been done by the legal service authorities, Delhi Legal Service Authority. They are facing certain specific problems also with regard to the interviewing of clients and counseling also. So in those areas, now the government of India has decided to create a different standard altogether for which they are working upon it also. So this clinical law, basic law clinic, can actually play a very important role to create the rapport between the law school and the society altogether. And again, the access of justice is another very important point, as noted by the previous speaker. Article 39A of the Constitution of India seems to be one of the important and the fundamental grundnorm was discussed about access to justice also. And it has been quoted from Universal Declaration of Human Rights that how these things may play a very important role also. In our country, we have cost is a very, very important and major issue altogether, that is cost of litigations, gaps in legal literacy. So these are the concerns which may play a very important role. There are certain objectives of clinical legal education which seems to be important. Number one, we're going to provide opportunity to students to perform. Number two, they prepare the students for the placement, and then they can expose the students to the realities of life also. We have seen that in many, whenever we do any kind of event for with regard to ADR activities also, we have found out that in all those people who are living in the slum areas or living in the, you can say, unauthorized colonies, they are facing number of problems also. So in those situations, it is very difficult to stimulate the alternative dispute mechanisms for the students also. And there the idea is also plays a very important role to give a paradigm shift from the traditional legal system to modern legal system. In many European countries, it seems to be a very successful area also. In Singapore also, in NUS law school is working upon the same model. But in our country, only in the metropolitan cities, it seems to be a moderate success. But I can say in the rural area, in the tier 2 states also, they are going to face major problems because of the lack of infrastructures and the lack of financial support from the state legal service authority, as well as from the state government also. I have seen that there are many the state legal service authorities who are not ready and who are not viable enough to come to organize various camps, which is necessary, which has been done by and has been instructed by the senior body, that is the National State Legal Service Authority also. So this seems to be a very important challenge. Now there are many clinical programs which has been operated from the last 20 years. Moot Court was initiated way back in the 1980s also. Legal Aid again in 1980s, it's there. Mock trial seems to be a very new area. From the last 10 years it has been. Lok Adalat is also very important here. Nowadays, there are very few law schools who are working upon it. When I did my empirical research in Delhi as well as in Uttar Pradesh, we have found out that there are not many law schools who are working upon the Lok Adalat for their students. So this seems to be a very major concern. When I used to study in my previous colleges or other colleges as well, we have found out that Lok Adalat seems to be a very important area also. So there are certain things which seems to be very important altogether. But now the time has changed. There are few emerging law schools like Gujarat National University and other universities who are working more legal startups and legal incubation centers. Now, this is not something that these startups incubation centers may actually help the only for the commercial people or only for the commercial litigation. It can also provide legal services also to the rural area or to the needy person, I can say also. So this seems to be very important. Now these are the challenges, lack of legal clinical education also, and where I've seen with my research also, the extensive research which I've done in 5 states, I found out that yes, there's a complete lack of legal education also, lack of dedicated legal aid councils also, this is also seems to be very important. Budget restraint altogether, no idea of legal aid activity. It seems to be very strange, but I put forward as a bold challenge altogether, because there are many legal aid coordinators, with all due respect to the professors also, they do not have know that how legal aid activities can be done. The main reason is the lack of support from the senior authorities. The people, the education institutions, they are working upon through the profit-oriented institutions, since they are the private company institutions. So only in those particular areas they are working, and there they do not have knowledge about how the legal aid activities can actually work also. Restriction of faculty to practice. There are many developed countries where the faculty members across the European countries I have seen, and I have interacted with many people across in many international level also. The faculty members allowed to practice also. But in our country, there is a certain restrictions which has been imposed by Bar Council of India, and as well as by the law, that is Advocates Act, where there's been restriction of faculty to practice also. Again, it is a very debatable issue. I will not doubt upon it. But again, the time has also has come to bring certain change altogether with regard to remove this restriction. At least a partial restriction can be there for faculty to practice also. Absence of academic credit for the students also, as said by the previous speaker also, that the time has come to make pro bono services as a compulsory paper in every subject also. Nowadays, only few law schools who are working on it also, like NLUD, IP universities, and other traditional and national universities. But not every university is actually working upon the same direction. So that is why the absence of academic credit seems to be very important. Where you can encourage the students to work upon the academic credit altogether. Legal aid not being a part of workload for the faculty members. There are many faculty members who are extensively devoted their time for the legal aid activities and other legal services also. But unfortunately, it has not been taken as an important point for their career advancement scheme altogether. Now the time has came to even to bring change in the career advancement scheme, where the legal aid activities can be given certain substantial point altogether, so that the other faculty members can also contribute to the society. Because whatever we read the law, it is important that we need to understand the particular situation also. Now, so there is a question I will respond in the end. So involvement of the bar is also seems to be very important altogether. Now there are certain other challenges which seems to be important: the lack of required library resources, the communication gap between BCD, BCI, and the all those states as well altogether. And those issues which has been raised altogether, there have been many updates which has been given by Bar Council of India, but we have seen that there is a contradiction between the guidelines of the Bar Council of India and the UGC model altogether. So there it seems to be very emerging area altogether. Now, what are the suggestions? I can suggest one thing, that the social role of clinical clinics must be recognized also, not on the paper only, but not from the school point of view, but from the administrative point of view altogether. That at an university level, Hello. The social role of law clinics must be recognized. Second thing is the coordination between law clinics and legal service authority. Even today, the laws, I'm sorry to say, but legal service authorities in our country.
Hello.
Hello. Yes. Am I audible, ma'am? Hello. Hello. Am I audible? Hello? Moderator, ma'am?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Hello.
Thank you. So I'm going to wrap up very soon. So the coordination between law clinics and legal service authority also, this is again seems to be very important here. I have seen very interestingly also that in many metropolitan cities also, the legal service authority are actually looking for the points altogether. And that this is a very harsh reality, which I'm there also, that they are not actually involved themselves in training of the impanel law. One of my professor, known professor who has done an extensive national project with ICSSR, for the impanel lords, and there they have seen that the legal education is a FAQ altogether. So this is another very important area altogether.
Can you
hello? So the third point, which is important altogether, there I have seen that there are certain clinical educations which needs to be important. One is the access to justice clinic. Social enterprise clinic seems to be very important altogether. Now, why I'm saying social enterprise clinic altogether, because as I said, the incubation centers and the startup seems to be a very important area altogether. Now, the time has come that all those companies, I think, ma'am, there is a network issue maybe from your side, because
there seems to be some fluctuation with the network. If I'm not wrong,
am I audible? I think I'm audible to other speakers, ma'am. Please see them. So
I think there was a question with regard to the sample size and method of sampling.
I'm going to finish very soon. Then after that, I can answer. Social enterprise clinic seems to be a very important area also. As I said, the incubation center seems to be a very important area also. Nowadays, not many institutes who are working about the incubation centers altogether. Now, the law and economics is a very unique relationship altogether. So considering the situation, considering the plight of the migrant workers and the internally displaced persons in this pandemic phase altogether, and in the post-pandemic phase altogether, social clinic enterprise clinic seems to be one of the important areas. So I can recommend that all...
So I believe Subir sir is, I think he also lost his network.
Hello, am I audible, ma'am? So social clinic enterprise clinic seems to be an important area.
So
second one is.
So I think we will proceed, and maybe when sir's back, we can take the question about the sample size and on what was the method of sampling followed by that.
So that would bring us to the last
presentation. That is actually my presentation. I'll share my screen.
Ma'am, I'm audible. I think there is a certain network. Hello.
I hope my presentation is clear. Subir sir, are you back? Yes, ma'am.
Let me complete my presentation, ma'am. Hello. Hello. Ma'am, I'm audible to other speakers. They have also texted me, I think. So let me complete. I'm going to wrap it very soon also. Hello. Nitish sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. So let me finish very quickly. I also made a suggestion that the app for the learning and the access to justice for the lawyers can also be included. As I said, that the legal education seems to be one of the important challenge altogether for many many lawyers, legal aid councils in our country also. So now the Department of the Justice is working upon the same. So in the near future, maybe we can create an app altogether for the learning and access to justice. So with the help of these, with the legal, I can say, the startup and incubation center, there seems to be a very important area and where we can work upon it altogether. So this is the brief presentation altogether, despite being the glitches which we have. Now there are a few questions which has been asked. So let me see the first question. I think the first question has been asked by the Nitish. What is your sample size and the method of sampling also? Well, sir, we have this is our national project with the Department of Justice also, where I have been part of the as a co-investigator altogether. There are five faculty members in which we are involved. So we have covered four states basically, Delhi, Uttar Pradesh, and Himachal Pradesh, and Punjab also. And where we have made the questionnaires for the law schools, for the honorable judges as well also, and for the impaneled lawyers also. And there, the type of questions which we ask with regard to digitization of the legal aid. So the main target is whether the digitization of legal aid society is necessary in contemporary situation also or not. So the kind of the suggestions which we have received and the kind of work which we have done in our law schools, we are trying to do a comparative law, I can say comparative analysis, where we have found out that there are many glitches, there are many challenges which we are actually facing also. So this is an approach which we have taken altogether. And in the near future, as I said, I'm working upon the water conservation policy, for which seems to be a very important area, since environmental issues seems to be one of the major area in our country, especially in Delhi also. Any other question, please let me ask, or the, I think, moderator ma'am can proceed with her question.
Yes, I'm so sorry for the confusion. There was a technical challenge from my side.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much for such a wonderful presentation. The fact that you're also involved with the government project, especially in the area of legal aid in this situation, is remarkable. I believe the questions are done. Any more questions? So, sir, I just have a question for you in terms of clarification. What is the involvement of students in the project? Do you have students also as part of the project, and they're also involved with finding out different modes?
Yes, ma'am. We also involve our students, and we involve our PhD scholars, LLM, and the LLB students also. There is no doubt of the fact that the LLB students, I find LLB students more energetic altogether. But my PhD scholars, my PhD students seems to be very, they are very quite successful in executing the plan altogether because of their experience also. And yes, the students actually plays a very important role altogether, either as a paralegal volunteer or as a legal aid cell volunteer altogether. And I'm sure that we have seen that wherever I've given recommendations to my students for pursuing their higher education in abroad, across the world altogether, we have seen that all those students who have actually worked upon the legal aid services and where they have worked upon pro bono services, there seems to be a very important area for them also. But since the problem which we are facing even today also, because of the language issues, because of the regional barriers also, there are certain language barriers, there are certain regional barriers altogether, for which the imparting the knowledge seems to be very important. So we have to create a conducive environment where we can interact with the society. Because I have seen that in many local areas, we have seen certain hostility. And the local areas have said that you must be certain NGO who are working upon it for your vested interest. And you are here for certain formalities. So we have seen certain challenges. What I've seen altogether, I'm trying to encourage my students that you need to first bridge the communication gap between the society and yourself also. Once you bridge the communication gap, then the concerned persons will raise their issues, they will raise their problems, then you can involve themselves. So apart from the legal awareness, this is also seems to be a very important area also, where they do not put confidence upon the impaneled lawyers also.
Perfect. Thank you so much, sir, for the